Why is he sitting with me?
That one? The one near the record button?
Bismillah.
Rahman Rahim. Welcome to another episode of Coffee with Karim. I am your host, Karim Sirajuddin. I am here with Imam Jamaal Diwan. He is one of the founders of the Majlis in Orange County, California. Sheikh Jamaal, pleasure to have you on the show, sir.
A pleasure.
So tell us more about the Majlis and what's the vision of this space?
Yeah, that's a really complicated question in some ways. The Majlis really, there's the short story and there's the long story. The short story is basically that all we want to do essentially at the Majlis is to try to embody something similar to the example of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which I think everyone would probably say with their projects, but basically what it comes down to is trying to provide a space that's comfortable for people to engage with religious teaching, some sort of commitment to spiritual refinement, and to being with one another in companionship, and to trying to give back to the world around them.
Mm-hmm.
And as simple as it sounds, I think that many of our spaces, basically the idea behind the space is for it to be people-centered,
right,
and people-focused rather than anything else. And so everything that we do is really to bring the people together and to try to give them something that will improve them and their lives and their relationships with one another.
Mm-hmm. It's kind of like an incubator to learn and live Islam, perhaps in a, I don't want to say a fresh way, but perhaps in a different way from maybe some of the common experiences that we may have had at, you know, local masajid or stuff like that. Not to say that all masajid are not great spaces, but you know, there are stories, of course, yeah, right? Spaces, we all have them.
Every space has its limitations.
Yeah, exactly. So I wanted to ask you, I mean, I know you offer pastoral care providing and different types of, you know, spiritual counsel. You teach from classical texts. And what is the difference between religion and spirituality, in your opinion? It is a very common debate these days. Like, people will say something like, I consider myself spiritual, but not religious. Or, no, there's no such thing as spirituality in Islam. It's just religion or the deen. Mm. Are those two things different? Or what's your advice or feedback on that question?
Yeah. Well, you know, I think as always, we get into the issue of what are the definitions that people are functioning with. So when someone says religion, what do they mean? When they say spirituality, what do they mean? And oftentimes, the related question to that is, perhaps, why do they mean what they mean? Or what's the backstory to that?
Hmm.
I think for many people who kind of say, I'm spiritual, but I'm not religious, I feel like a lot of that has to do with their experience with religion.
Right.
And they're deep down inside, they realize that there's more to life than just the material things that are around us. And they know that the great spiritual traditions of the world and religions and so on have something to offer in that regard.
Hmm.
But oftentimes their experience with that religious thing in an organized way can be something that pushes them away. And I think that that's true for people of Christian heritage for sure. And I think it's also true for people that are from the Muslim tradition as well.
Yeah. It's like you're lost existentially. You find, let's say, a religion. And if it happens to be Islam, there's a high chance, you know, you come in with these rosy goggles of like, wow, I read the seerah and this is the truth. I want to live, you know, according to this.
Mm-hmm.
And then you go to your local masjid and there could be a very different experience. Like, mm-hmm, all of a sudden it's about, you know, heavy emphasis on legal transactions of, mm-hmm, the religion. Or, you know, you're basically told you're not really Muslim until you change your identity fundamentally, or your culture, the way, mm-hmm, you dress, the way you talk, whatever, mm-hmm, it is, right? So what do you think is going on there? Then people end up spiritual. So, you know, does that mean they just kind of like, okay, that means I'm going to take what I want and kind of make it help? Whatever I use from religion to make me feel good,
mm,
sometimes could be one understanding of what it means to be spiritual, right, perhaps. Right. What are your thoughts about that?
Well, on the last point, I think that that's not necessarily a good thing, right? Like, whatever we can take from the religion to make us feel good is being spiritual. Sometimes that could be good. I mean, we do feel good when we do spiritual things, but it's just not that those are always going to be easy. So there's a fine line there, I think. But, you know, people, we have, I think, oftentimes this tension between the ideal and the real.
Mm.
And we definitely experience that in the Muslim community. But I mean, we always tell people, judge Islam by what it is, not by what Muslims do.
Right.
And that's kind of like basically calling people to this, to recognize the real versus ideal.
I saw a bumper sticker once that said, "Oh God, save me from your followers."
Yeah. it's pretty good, actually. Right? Followers, you put it in quotes, right? Those who think they're following you.
Right.
But I think that's an ongoing challenge for people. And then, you know, spirituality, I think, is very similar to a lot of things, which is that there's some truth about there being things greater than ourselves, greater than the material in front of us. And different places you'll find some glimpses of that truth. But the challenge is when you pick different things from different places, they don't come together in an integrated whole. And I think that's where you see a lot of difficulties here in the questions of spirituality. And in greater American society, I think you see this as a broader trend, that you see this category of people who kind of recognize that this perspective, where we've come to culturally as a people, there's something missing from it.
Mm.
And so you see, you know, all types of different things, a concern for the environment, people all interested in yoga, people, as always, you have this kind of, for the last 50 years, probably 60 years, this interest in Eastern religion.
Yeah, it's like the human being always wants to satiate something. Right? Yeah, there's always some empty cup.
But you try to bring it in, and I'm going to integrate this into my life, but it doesn't always work because the rest of it is not. It's like you're taking, to use like a heavy Muslim advanced example, you're studying fiqh without a madhab.
Mm.
So you have opinions from different places, but it doesn't make sense as a whole.
It's like having a steering wheel without a car.
Yeah.
Or brakes in the steering wheel, but holistic system is what you're kind of saying.
It's like I really want a Mercedes. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to get a Mercedes logo symbol off someone else's car. I'm going to put it on my car.
Right.
And now I'm going to feel like I have a Mercedes, but you don't have a Mercedes. The inside is still not the same.
Exactly. Right. So what I'm hearing you say is labels or personal assignment to a tradition or practice or religion, naturally that's your starting point. And it's also the point that can help you, let's say, correct or harmonize your very perception with, you know, what is meant to be the truth or the path of that religion or tradition or philosophy, perhaps.
Mm. Yeah, I think that... I don't know if I'm understanding exactly what you're saying right, but I think that, for example, one of our teachers used to tell us, if you want to become a really good poet, the first thing you do is you memorize poetry.
Mm.
And after you've memorized enough poetry, you get to a point where you're able to actually independently contribute to the world of poetry.
I can relate to that, because I know the more songs I learned on guitar, the more I was able to write better songs.
Mm-hmm. And I think that that's true for other things too. So, for example, I want to have some sort of, you would see it actually in the books of law, again, you know, and like a Sharia side of things, is that people would choose a madhab. They study their school of interpretation. And it's once they reach a high level in their school of interpretation that now they start to question some of the conclusions of their school.
Right.
Or how it applies to the evidences and so on and so forth.
Right.
But there has to be some level of disciplining in the training that gets it. And maybe that's related to spirituality too, because you know, I believe that part of spirituality is gaining almost like a base level of it is gaining some sort of discipline over the self that allows us to dig deeper into other things.
Right.
And if our initial interactions then with the spirituality are things that are just whatever I feel like, I'm not going to gain that discipline.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I have thought about these things a long time myself, and it's always nice to hear other people's input. And like, you know, I think a great place to always start is with, of course, fundamentally language, right? You look at the word religion.
Mm-hmm.
From what I recall, don't quote me, guys, but religio is Latin for like yoke or to bind together.
Okay.
So it's about bringing something together. Spiritus is Latin for all the things we already know spirit means. It's like life, it's spirit, it's, you know, energy, force, self. And then take the word deen in Arabic, correct me if I'm wrong, isn't it root connected to the same root for dain, like a debt? So is that accurate?
A debt, or? And also, yeah, like recompense. Yom Ad-Din.
Right.
Malik Yom Ad-Din is the day of when all the debts are paid, basically.
Yeah. So the indebted is, you're being indebted to the fact that Allah gave you the gift of consciousness and life and a taste of His eternal attributes as a, you know, package to work with in your own existence, right? Like that's the, so we're indebted to the fact that Allah gave us this. And I always say, like, imagine if I was super wealthy and I had, you know, this awesome house and Malibu, and I was like, I'm always very generous with my friends. Just take the keys, go with your family, get away, have fun, and use the car, eat the food, there's cooks, and I'm giving you this huge amana of all this property and wealth and, you know, great times, right? But you can also lose that amana with me and not fulfill the trust, right? And if you crash my Ferrari or you know, burn my house down, you're going to be extremely indebted for the favor that I trusted you with, right? So that's just a simple human analogy. Imagine now the creator who's eternal needs nothing and chose to create you or me or Donald Trump, and we use our life to live in, you know, forgetfulness, heedlessness, or we align ourselves with the divine pattern, or we choose to actually rebel and go against it, right? And be part of the evil army. So, you know, just those, you know, those terms, and of course, ruh in Arabic is spirit and life force, and there's this tranquility and etc. So I think at least one of the ways I've kind of seen it, because I've gone through my own journey with religion and this, is that, you know, perhaps religion is more about the collective emphasis of a worldview. And that requires communitarian or collective, you know, patterns and laws and transactions and formalities. And spirituality is more of the personal taste that you get out of that collective effort. In other words, religion is organized spirituality. But if we lose that sense that it is organized spirituality, then it can become politicized, institutionalized, you know, whatever, and then it becomes kind of a different thing rather than what it was always meant to be. Because when I, for example, just reflect on the seerah, you know, the first, what, 11 years of the seerah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, there was no five daily prayers, right? And then it came once they already had a lot of theology, you know, purification of theology, social justice change, right? And then the salah came to anchor them in their love of Allah and the Prophet and the iman that they had to keep it organized. The five daily prayers. Is that accurate?
There was salah before that, but it was in the morning and the evening.
Did they do the actual sajda, like the same exact format, or was it a, do we have any knowledge about, was it meditation, was it still a type of sajda, or...
I can't remember exactly, but I believe it was similar. But I'm not entirely sure. I would have to review. I can't remember right now.
Because Isra Ma'raj happened at that point about, what, 10 years in? Or was it earlier?
About 10, 11 years in.
And that's when we got the official formalization of the five daily prayers. Yeah. And then
but
after
Jibreel came to him and taught him the salah before that.
Right.
And that's, he taught Khadija radiallahu anha very early.
So it might have been even a private practice.
And they used to go out, and they say they used to go out to the outskirts of Mecca and pray in the morning and the evening, and you know, try to not get caught, basically.
Well,
but the five definitely comes later, and even if it's two, I mean, two is, it's organized still. That's an interesting breakdown: organized spirituality versus.
Because spirituality is, you know, if you look at it with psychology, spiritual psychology, transpersonal, it's about, like you started off saying, it's about relating and developing meaning in relation to the bigger picture and beyond yourself and your ego, right? So whatever I'm doing, I am always part of this massive ocean of water that's has its own current, but I'm also a part of it, you know? So it's like, that's why you can have people practicing the same religion, but someone's at spirituality level 100 and the other is at negative 100, and the whole everything in between, even though they're practicing the same things or they're in the same gatherings. So doesn't that really suggest this subjective intention, psychological, you know, effort, sincerity, and relationship that that person actually has with the divine? Because it's like a toolkit, right?
There's something else going on inside.
Because you're not going to get the same results for everybody. right?
No, I mean, that's, it's one of the most, I think, one of the statements that really sticks with me a lot is a statement of, I believe it was Al-Fudayl ibn Iyad, but it's attributed to different people, that the people who came before you, they didn't reach what they reached because of praying a lot and fasting a lot and giving a lot in charity. Which is not to say that they didn't do a lot of those things, but they didn't reach what they reached with God through those things. They reached it through sakha'u nafs wa salamatu sadr wa nusha lil ummah. That they had this, yeah, they had this generosity of spirit and cleanliness of heart, open-heartedness, like they don't hold anything against anyone, and that they give sincere advice to everyone. You know,
Mashallah.
Those are all issues of the heart in the end. They're not. So someone can be more sincere in that. Someone can be, some people experience different levels of things in their hearts. But I think even, you know, sometimes I wonder with spirituality and kind of how that fits into our tradition and just the terms. Because, you know, in the end, in Hadith Jibreel, alayhi salam, Gabriel, the Hadith of Gabriel, when he comes to the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he talks to him about Iman and Islam and Ihsan, you know, belief, the six articles of faith he mentions, God, messengers, angels, Day of Judgment, so on. He mentions the acts of worship. And then he mentions worshipping God as if you see him. And even if you don't see him, you know that he sees you. And so the scholars have often said that these represent three major branches of Islamic studies, right? You have theology, and you have law, and you have spirituality. And all of those are deen.
Right.
That all of those are the way. Another meaning of deen, by the way, has to do with kind of like how you do things.
Hmm.
So, kemetidinu tudan.
Right.
As you do to others, it will be done to you. So all of these fall into our relationship with God.
Right.
Really. And so